إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا ومولانا محمد وبارك وسلم صلاة وسلام عليك يا سيدي يا حبيبي يا رسول الله صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم. All praises are due to Allah, the Creator, the Sustainer. Peace, blessings and salutations upon the greatest of His creation, Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Indeed, we are present here in the Jalsa of Madrasa Uwaisiyah, and these Jalsas which take place, the reason behind it or the wisdom behind it is to actually encourage the students to study even harder in the studies of Islam. And it also displays the hard work of the teachers and their input in the madrasa. The child works hard throughout the year, learns whatever has been taught to them by the teachers. But at the end of the year, the reason why we have these trophies and certificates is to encourage them and motivate them towards learning the deen and towards being more interested in learning the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I will take this opportunity to also present a kalam, inshallah. And this kalam has got nisbat to the beautiful month which we have already entered. And the reason why I'm presenting it is the ash'ar have a lot of proof and meaning towards actually what this beautiful month and what we do in this beautiful month. So the shayr has said, before we start, let us all recite Durood Sharif together. Sallallahu alayka ya Rasulallah wa sallam alayka ya Habibullah.
Mustafa ko
to a life with the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he says, the shahid is saying that we think that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is majboor, he cannot do anything. People say that. The ignorant people say that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam could not, he did not even know behind his back, or he did not even know behind the wall. Ma'azallah, astaghfirullah. But this, the shahid is saying that if the wali of Allah can do this, then what is the maqam of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? That is what he's trying to explain. In the next year, the shahid says, Ke balkar ghamar ki lona har sirt ghoomta hai, balkar ghamar ki lona har sirt ghoomta hai, jis that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that wherever he would move his beautiful and blessed finger, he would find that the blessed finger is moving, the moon is also moving in the same direction. That is what the shahid is trying to explain. Another mu'jiza, miracle of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the shahid says, kafara darakht dora shakhe chuka chuka ke.
Short and sweet, so that the next time if I have to speak, then you don't have to get bored and to think to yourself that when he comes onto the mic, he's going to take forever to leave the mic. So do not worry about that fact, inshallah. We will terminate. But the message which I actually thought of, and you know, when I was driving, when we were driving together and returning, you know, in today's time, it's quite sad that we think to ourselves, you know, what is the main exam of our life? Is it actually getting that bachelor's degree in our hands? Is it actually passing the matric exams? with the highest marks? Is it getting distinctions in all the years of our studies? Because if you really look at it, and if you really look at the scenario of the amount of Muslims we are in South Africa, the amount of people we are who read the kalima La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it's a sad state that we will find that many do not even know how to read the Quran in the correct manner. It's a sad state. But then, when you look at their degrees, when you walk into their offices, you will find a frame that bachelor's degree, University of South Africa. You will find the diploma, you will find the certificate, and you'll find all the achievements which they have achieved in this dunya. And indeed, no one refuses. Remember, we make dua, رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنًا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنًا. No one refuses that you should be ignorant in this dunya. No one says that we should be ignorant. But the point is that give a comparison in your mind. Think to yourself, each one of us seated here, and all those sisters listening to me, then how many of us actually give the importance of how we give importance to the studies of school, we give the same importance to the studies in madrasa? We have Maulana Sahib here, we have Maulana Sikandar Sahib, who is the principal of this madrasa. Ask them, and you will find that the child actually, when the parent will come to the madrasa, and he will say or she will say that, Maulana, today my child, I will take him home early because tomorrow he has a very big exam. You find these situations. Sometimes they don't even come. Maulana Sahib is testifying what I'm saying. So it's not actually coming out from my cooking. It's not something which I'm making up to make a story up for this program. But it's a real fact. You know, when I used to have the opportunity to be the director of the madaris and the maktabs in Malawi, it used to be the same problem. The children would go to school on time. They would never be late. But when it comes to madrasa, they are late. They will not come on time. Why? Because we as the parents, remember that we are the foundation of our children. We are actually the pillars of our children's education. Because when you find a building, it stands on pillars. You can see that this wall actually has these pillars, which is carrying the trusses, which is carrying the roof for you. In the same way, we as parents are carrying the education and responsible for the education of our children. If we can give importance to the exams of matric and school exams, then let me tell you that the real exam and the main exam is not what you are writing in your matric. It's not when you get your bachelor's degree. It's not when you pass your grade 10, grade 11, grade 12. But the real exam is when you are asked, Man Rabbuka, Ma Dinuka, Ma Kunta Taqulu Fi Hadha Rajul, Aw Kama Qal, that when these questions are asked in the grave, that what is your deen, Man Rabbuka, who is your Lord, Ma Dinuka, what is your religion, and what you used to say about him in this dunya, if these questions are passed, that is the real success for the Akhirah. This is the real exam we have to pass. This is the real exam which we have to achieve. This is the real exam which we need to get distinctions in. This is what we need to pass. And where will you learn this? This is your madrasa. This is the maktab which you will send your children to. This is where you have to give importance. No one says that don't send your children to school. You need school education today. Because when you will have school education, you will be able to keep up with the times today. You will be able to keep up with the media today. You will be able to keep up with the socializing with the people and actually going and meeting them and talking to them. So it's very important. School education, not that we should deprive our children. But look at the sad state of the Muslim Ummah. That actually we are giving more importance. Remember, it's a very beautiful saying that, you know, the saying which came into my mind is that we today, if we are going to think of the future of our children, then we have instilled that our children will now think about the future of their children. You are starting the trend. So this is the saying which I want to give to you, that you need to actually put the seed in of Islam. Why do you, who is the first teacher? Do you know? Who is the first teacher of the children? It's not the Maulana at the madrasa. It's the mother. It's actually your wives. mothers of your children, because when you are at work, the mother is at home. Up to 4 years or 5 years, the child stays with the mother. Now you tell me that if the mother does not even respect the azan and is not even able to put on the scarf, why is the azan takes place to give respect to actually those words which are so beneficial that when we as the listeners of the azan according to the hadith, if we are to repeat what the muazzin says, we get the same reward as the muazzin. The beauty, if you as parents, if that mother is not able to actually put the scarf on, if you as the fathers sitting in the homes at the time of Maghrib Salah, putting your feet up and watching television, and you will say that your child will have the best of Islam in him, then I'm very sorry, my fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, that is totally incorrect. And I guarantee and I can sign on the fact that you will only be lucky that if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has actually blessed you with a pious child who has not considered what the parents are doing, but he's gone on to his own path of Islam, following the way of Allah, you will be very lucky. But if you are not lucky, then indeed, you are responsible for your children. Who will you give the responsibility to? You will give it to the Maulana who is only there for 1 hour or 2 hours. You are the first. Remember, the mother is the first teacher. If the parent actually at the time of azan, remember, I'm not trying to support that you should have television. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us from this fitna. Actually, you know that we today in our homes, if we have the biggest dajjal in the house is our television, that whenever the child gets the best time which he has to actually spend in learning the deen, he will sit in front of the TV. Why? Because that's what his parents are doing. That's what actually his parents are. Look, there might be pious parents in this gathering. There might be pious parents listening to me. So don't take it as an attack. Take it positively. Let us make a change. I could also be part of what I'm saying. Not that all of us are just, you know, we've come into this dunya from Jannah and we are the most pious people. We all have to strive to become good people. When we will strive to become good people, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows our intentions in our heart, that what do we want to achieve. So the point is that we at the time of azan, I was saying that if the mother does not put on the scarf and say that put off everything, sit down, listen to the azan, answer the azan. That is the teaching, that if you as the parent, or if you have given the children the education of Islam, then when they will grow up and become parents, then they will follow that way of Islam. You need to do it now. What is gone is gone. Whatever has passed is passed. You can always have a new start. You have your children today, they will be mothers tomorrow. Today's children will be tomorrow's parents. So if they will be having the education in their homes to say that when it is azan time, let us all sit with respect, do not talk. You know, you could be deprived by reading the kalima when you are leaving from this dunya if you are engaging in worldly talks at the time of azan. Not respecting the azan. This is just one aspect. Let's look at more aspects. Let's look at this. You know, one family I visited, I will not mention the country, so it remains as an anonymous situation. But it's not fiction, it's actually the fact. Alhamdulillah, father says, Maulana, I follow the way of the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. You know, he tells me that I actually, when I invited my son for the Fatiha of my father, these are his words. You know, he tells me, Maulana, you won't believe it what my son said. I educated him. Today he has a degree. He's a professional. No harm in becoming professional, as I mentioned. He became a professional, but he was lacking that bit of Islam or that bit of Islamic mindset in himself. That when the father actually invited him for the grandfather's Fatiha, and he comes, do you know what he says to his father? Do you know I had to cancel a meeting to come for this Fatiha? And when I was sitting with him, me and him alone in the car, and I'm telling him that I think, look at the way this dunya, the education of this dunya, has actually ruined his respect. That today, imagine it's his grandfather. The father is calling him the says, I had to actually cancel a meeting to come for this Fatiha. What will the father feel in his heart? And we today, if we are going to complain that Maulana, my children are not respecting me, then you have not given them the etiquette and the necessary education which they require. Because the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ says, a beautiful poem, that who should I give my love to, my respect and my honor to? Who should I give my love to after Allah and Rasulullah? I want all the children to say what? Comes your mother. Who comes? All of you together. Who comes?
Your mother.
How many times?
Three times.
I said it in this note, so we have children in the gathering, so they can also be entertained with this. So, if the madrasa which they are going in and they have been given this mindset, they have been taught that after Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you give love to your mother. After your mother, again your mother. After your mother, again your mother, three times, and then your father. The hadith says, what about the father? The hadith says that رِضَ اللَّهِ فِي رِضَ الْوَالِدِ وَسَخْتُ اللَّهِ فِي سَخْتِ الْوَالِدِ أَوْ كَمَا قَالَ عَلَيْهِ الصَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ. That the pleasure of Allah lies in the pleasure of your father. And the anger of Allah lies in the anger of your father. So fathers, mothers, this respect is taught in the madrasa. This is the topic which I'm sharing with you, that we spoke about the first and the main exam of our life are the three questions which we will be asked in the grave. We've spoken about the first teacher in the house is the mother. The actual mindset which we should give to the children, that if you are as a father or mother sitting and not performing your salah, what have you passed on to your children? If you will not wake up your children from a young age for Fajr Salah, look at the masajid. You know, it is so sad. It is so sad that actually, you know, the masajid are empty at the time of Fajr Salah. And we claim to say that we love Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when we are claiming to say that we are the real ashiks, I can guarantee and say this for a fact, that the real ashik is he who cannot even miss one rakat of his salah deliberately. Because that is the coolness of the eyes of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. All these are the teachings which you will get in the madrasa. Don't remove your children from the madrasa. Let them go, that 1 or 2 hours will make your akhirah. Because there are only three things which will benefit you after you leave this world. The first thing which will benefit you is knowledge. If you have shared knowledge, if you have been part of that world which is actually shared knowledge, that will benefit you after you leave this world. If you, the second thing which will benefit you is continuous dawah. For example, planting a tree that is continuous, dawah jariyah, giving water to the people who do not have water, having a borehole. Now, you know, when the question comes, that when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was asked that what should I do for my mother, this is the summary of the hadith, not actually the quotation, the summary of the hadith which I am giving to you, because when we don't say the summary, and if we have missaid or we have not said the actual translation of the hadith, then we could be accountable for giving the wrong translation. So that's why we say summary. The summary of that hadith, that when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was asked that what should I do for my mother, what was the answer? A well. Water. Water was the answer, but you'll dig a well or you'll dig a borehole, and that will be water as a gift. Now the question is, just logically think to yourself, that if water is being given to people to drink, and that can reward your parents who have left this world. So if I read Surah Al-Fatiha and send to my parents, will that not be able to reach my parents? Think to yourself, you know. You find these objections. I've just mentioned this because we're talking about very simple, something which anyone can understand. Not going into the technicalities and giving you the dalail, but just the simple thing. If water can reach, Quran cannot reach. They cannot benefit after they have left this world. So coming back to the point, that sawab-e-jariya, continuous sawab, will benefit you. And the third thing is a pious child. How will that pious child benefit you after you have left? These are your three assets. If you have 10 properties, if you have 10 homes, if you have 10 cars, you have the best Mercedes or BMW, that will not take you to the Qabristan, that will not take you to the graveyard. It's going to be the same hearse of the services which you have available, which is going to take you to the graveyard. And when you go to the graveyard, and once you are buried, then there's only 3 assets which you have. And these are the 3 assets which I've mentioned to you. It's education, knowledge. Knowledge of deen. It's knowledge of deen. Remember, don't misinterpret it. Yes, learning maths. Remember that miras has been told as half of ilm. Learning maths is not a sin, as I mentioned to you. That learning the deen with the dunya is not incorrect. You must have deen and dunya together, because we need to conquer the world as Muslims. We can only conquer and we can only be successful in the work of deen or in the field of knowledge if we are actually having the knowledge of this dunya as well, because everything requires permissions. You need to do a lot of things on the computer. If you do not have that education, how will you do it? So these are your 3 assets. And this 3rd asset is what we are discussing, that the madrasa is what gives them the education. Make them alim. I say that in today's time, this is the statement of the akabirin. What am I? I am nothing. I am the servant of the ulama, of the pious servants of Allah. We are there actually ghulam, that they have actually given us the opportunity to be their ghulam as well. So those personalities have said that in today's time, it is necessary to have an alim in every family. Every family should at least have one alim. But how much have we given this education? How much have we given importance to it? Remember that when someone is studying to become a doctor, when he is studying to become an engineer, these are the books which have been written by humans. But when he is studying to become an alim, he is studying the kitab which is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When he is studying to become an alim, he is learning the hadith which is from Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When he is studying the deen, the angels have put their wings under the feet of those students who are studying the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what more can we tell you? What more can I share with you? And what more will I say? That imagine that this is the ahmiyat, this is the importance of the deen, of the education of deen. And if we are to neglect it, we are the losers ourselves. Because remember that these ulama are here to serve the deen. They are actually here to train your children, to give them the education of Islam. And if we ourselves, you remember one thing, that if there is a well, you know that there is water available. You can take the horse to the well, but you can't force it to drink the water, can you? You can't. So the task is that the madrasas are open. We have madaris here, alhamdulillah. Maulana sahab is running a madrasa. Maulana Hafiz sahab is running a madrasa. You have madaris. They are of the pure beliefs and the aqaid of the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jamaah. Send your children there. Let them learn. Keep the same beliefs what our grandfathers have left for us. Because remember, let me ask you one more question. That before, many of you have been living here for years. I know in our home country, that we all used to be performing salah in one masjid. We were all in one masjid. You know, the question I ask, that actually, sometimes they say that, no, we are becoming strong on aqaid, but I ask you a question, that we haven't brought anything new. We are doing whatever our forefathers left us with. We are doing the same milad which our grandfathers and forefathers used to do. We are doing the same Fatiha which our forefathers used to do. So the people who have actually come and created the problems, you have to understand and you have to make your mind to say that these people are the same people who are from the old mindset. They are the same ideology. But they are the ones who are saying, no, don't do this and no, don't do that. And they are changing our minds and trying to infest us with the wrong aqaid and the beliefs. But we ourselves have to make up the decision, because when it comes to business and when it comes to investments, you know, we actually have to ponder and think about it, that should I actually invest with this company? Should I put my money into this business? Should I do this? Why? Because the money is beloved to us. And when it comes to our time, oh, that, you know, anything goes, I am just someone. Are bhai, listen, understand that you are following the footsteps of your forefathers. They have taught you what they are doing. And you, if you you are going to change, then the first thing you are doing is going to the grave and giving your grandfather or forefather a slap on his face to say that you are doing shirk in your life. I am a Muslim. Is that what you are doing?
Allah.
Are you trying to say that your father or forefathers were wrong? Were they not on the right path? We were all on the same path. We were all on one path. We were all following one. And alhamdulillah, we are still blessed to be on that path. So, coming to the point before I had one more point in my mind. There's a lot of things, you know, when it comes to education or madrasa, there's a lot of things I would love to discuss, but I will terminate very shortly in 5 or 10 minutes, very quickly, last few points. Coming to the point, so understand that we are following the same masjid. Yes, sometimes we have lost the masajid because we have been forced out. We have to actually go, and now we haven't changed. We have brought nothing new. We are following the same deen with Ghawse Paak radiallahu anhu was following. We are following the same deen with Khaja Sahib was following. So, 200 years, 100 years old people who have actually brought a new mindset trying to stop and whatever agendas they have, Allah knows best. You will tell me, why am I telling you? So I'll tell you, Allah knows best what agendas they have. You think to yourself and you make up your mind. Coming to the point of education. Do you know that you can put a line of professionals, doctor, engineer, lawyer, all working in a firm, and you will put someone who has the knowledge of deen, who actually has the education from the Quran and the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Imagine his professionals all lined up. Doctors, lawyers, engineers, all these people. If it comes to the time of Salah, are you going to choose from the doctor, lawyer, engineer, or who is going to lead them in Salah? Although he might be on an underpaid, he might be an underpaid person, he might be on a salary of only 5,000, he might only be on a salary of 7,000. Which is really less. You can't run your homes in that much of salary, but you expect the ulama to be the happiest people, give you all the services, give you everything for that little amount of money. But still, Allahu Akbar, show me one alim who has stayed hungry in this dunya. Show me one hafiz of the Quran or alim of the deen who has actually stayed hungry without food in his home. But I can show you a professional who has stayed unemployed and has problems and is actually paying interest, which is haram, to the bank. He's paying interest. Remember, I'm talking about paying. He's actually paying, and he's actually having to do that because he's not employed, he doesn't have a job. But an alim who has actually learned the Quran and the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam never stays there. So the point is that that whole line of professionals who are seated or standing there, when it comes to the time of Salah, that person who has the knowledge of the deen, who has studied the deen from the Quran and the hadith, will be the imam, and all these professionals will be in the back. That is the blessings of learning the deen. That is the blessings of giving our children the education of deen. That is the blessings of sending them to the madaris. Again, if they don't need to actually be ignorant in this dunya. I've repeated this point so many times. I'm not saying that leave school and just concentrate on madrasa. No, school is important. Because if you will have school, you will find it easy to stay in this dunya, to do the work in this dunya. But let us not neglect these madaris. Let us not neglect the deen. Let us give it a priority. Let us make sure that we have not left it as, you know, just by, you know, passing by to say that, okay, fine, now my child is giving me hassle at home, send him to the madrasa. Think to yourself that this is your way to Jannah. And if your child is pious, and if he has the knowledge of deen, he will make dua for you. That is the third asset, which I am still completing to say, that the third asset is a pious child. What will the pious child do? He will make dua for you. But if he is not pious, if he has not got the knowledge of deen, then he will be one of those who will say that I don't have time. He will never visit you at the Qabrastan. He will never even think about you. When you will be in need of dawah, when you will be in need of reward, remember so many waqiyat, that when they have been given or when they have been sent the sawab of the Fatiha, they distribute it amongst themselves. So if you have a child who actually can't even come and make dua for you, but until and when, because you have taught him how to read or heard the Quran, until and when they will read the Quran for you, you will get the sawab in the grave. So you need to give them the education. You need to educate them. And the Quran itself is never too late. I'll encourage that adult classes be introduced. Don't feel shy. These ulama will come to you. If you will ask them and request them, if you feel shy, they will come to you. They will send a teacher to you. But learn the Quran. Learn how to read it. Even if you don't understand it, which is important to understand according to the Sunni translation, Alhamdulillah, which is Kanzul Iman, which we have. Even if you don't understand, just touching the Quran, reading the Quran, reading the verses from the Quran is sawab. It is reward for you. So, don't be deprived from this act of reading the Quran. Don't keep it in the highest shelf in your house. Read the Quran every day. Instill it in your children. Then start your day with Surah Yasin. If you start your day with Surah Yasin, whatever intentions you have in the day, your intentions will be fulfilled with the barakah and the blessings of Surah Yasin. So, mindset, Islamic mindset. No one is telling you to become a saint overnight. That's not the reason why I'm sitting here. You can't just say, okay, fine, stop this, stop that. No. Take a step at a time. The journey to success is a long journey. The journey to piety is a long journey. But it's upon ourselves. Erase a sin in your life, increase a sunnah in your life. Take away one sin, add one sunnah. You will find that if you will keep this, that this week I have this sin in myself. For example, you know, sometimes you have these urinals in the toilets, and when you find that the parents themselves, when the child goes with the, you know, the father to the toilet, and he finds that the father has taken a, you know, standing there like a fire brigade and starting to urinating there in the urinal, then what happens to the child? That he says that my father is actually doing this, which is against the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has taught us what? That we should sit down and urinate, you know? That will stop us from many sicknesses. Remember that, who was the doctor? In the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which university was open? The university of the Ashab al-Sufa. The university which was in Masjid al-Nabawi. The university itself, the founder of the University of Islam, Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That whenever they would have any sickness, they would go to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I have such and such problem. So everything is in the Quran and the Hadith. But we neglect it. Look at the beauty, you know. Look at the sunnah that when you drink water, you should first look inside the water. Many of us open it, off you go. But look at this sunnah, such simple sunnahs. Where will they learn? They will learn in the madrasa. If you neglect the madrasa, you don't know this. That's where the sicknesses come. In fact, you know, those people, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had found that there was someone who was being given punishment in the grave, and when the companions had asked, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned the reason was that that person would not save himself from the drops of urine. Imagine, azab in the grave. Just a simple act. So, there are many sunnahs which your children will instill into them. You as parents have time, go for the adult classes. I'm sure if you will show interest, because if I will tell the ulama, I can guarantee you that they will never refuse. Because they are ready for this, they have come for this. But it's upon you that you show some interest, because if you will find that now we've started the adult class, but no one to come out, so kya karenge maulana sahab? He'll go back home, he's going to do nothing. You need to show interest. Learn the deen, you will find that your akhirat, your dunya and your akhirat will become better with the blessings of the deen, with the learning of the deen and the education of deen. That is my message which I wanted to pass. Many more examples which I still have in the mind. But inshallah, let's not give everything now, so that we have something left for later on as well, inshallah. So we can discuss, understand the whole bottom line of this lengthy talk. which I have given here, Allah accept it inshaAllah, is that we should not neglect madrasa. Give it a priority. Make it a priority. We are not telling you to stop your school. The child is going to school, but don't make him miss madrasa. Have you ever made your child miss school because of madrasa exams? So actions, the saying which I wanted to say, which has come back in my mind, is that sometimes our actions speak louder than words, isn't it? We say that actions speak louder than words. So when we are saying these sayings, that actions speak louder than words, then our actions are actually saying that no, school is more important, madrasa is not that important. So I do not know many of you seated here, so it's not a personal message. I haven't been given a biography of everyone to say that, you know, this parent, that, no. It's a general message. If you feel offended in any way, remember that I've only spoken for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that this is the message which is our responsibility to pass to you. So if I made any mistake, you know, sometimes when we talk, there's slip of tongue, there's sometimes wrong translations. Sometimes it comes out as it's instead, sometimes it's a mistake. But I made tawbah if I made any mistake during the discourse in the translation of the ayat of the Quran or the ahadith, and ask Allah to accept my tawbah and ask Allah to guide us all to give madrasa education importance, inshaAllah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant madrasa Waseeha and all the madrasa of the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah success, inshaAllah. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make them great and great Islamic institutes of the Gauteng region, inshaAllah. That is my dua. Remember that everything has a start and it grows. But you need to give it support and it will grow. If you will neglect it now, then no university has just come up with a full setup and say, let me tell you of the university from where our asatiza are from, Ashrafiya, which is in India, actually started off with a small place and today it is a great Islamic university. So give it your support, support them. Don't just take it as, you know, passing by and, you know, not giving it importance. Hold their hands and move forward, inshallah. Ask Allah to forgive me once again. وَمَا تَوْفِيقِي إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ أَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهِ وَآخِرُ دَعْوَانَا عَنِ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ السَّلَامُ عَلَيْكُمْ وَرَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ وَبَرَكَاتُهُ.
وَعَلَيْكُمْ السَّلَامُ وَرَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ وَبَرَكَاتُهُ. We say to Zatullah, to Maulana Sahib, we have come from very far and gave us some words of wisdom which was very important, not only for the children, but for parents. You have mentioned the importance of parents educating their children. أَرَجُ اللَّهَ رَائِنْ فِي أَحْلِ بَيْتِهِ وَمَسْعُولٌ أَنْ رَأِيَتِهِ أَوْ كَمَا قَالَ عَلَيْهِ سَلَاتُ